That was because how I was the last time.
Untrue. Well, Marty knows more about Lake Hopatcong history and than almost anybody else. And I'm always amazed with the things that you have to tell us. I was so pleased to go on a boat ride recently with Marty, and I thought I knew a couple of things here and there about Lake Hopatcong, but I was surprised that there was much, much more to learn. And so the canal, of course, is interesting. The lake is interesting because, of course, it's involved with the canal, but it is a world of its own, and Marty's going to tell us all about it.
Thank you, Joe. Can everybody hear me okay? Because I kind of hate microphones, and I'm kind of known to be a little loud to begin with, so this might temper the two. And I will start by saying that this is really the scariest audience I ever have to do, because probably just about everybody out there knows more about the Morris Canal than I do. So my knowledge is really like a Hopatcong, as Anita knows, who works with me almost every Sunday at the Lake Hopatcong Museum. The canal is not my expertise, so you'll forgive me if I offend any of you about my knowledge of the canal, but we'll try to get it as close as we can. I was already asked tonight, no, that is not me on the Morris Canal. It was a young lad by the name of Richard Thompson. The photo showed up in our museum. We don't really know who he was, but he was good enough to have gotten around the Morris Canal. Okay, and I admit, that is not at Lake Hopatcong, but it was close enough being on Lake Musconetcong. Okay, now, Bob, I didn't know you would be here tonight, so thank you for the donation of the map. I've kind of stolen from a lot of you in the room, photos and everything else, but hopefully at least every one of you will see something by the time you leave tonight that you hadn't seen before. And we, you know, this is just kind of to remind everybody that the Lake Hopatcong was a key part of the Morris Canal. In fact, we always like to say at the museum that both Lake Hopatcong and the Morris Canal owe a lot to each other, because obviously it would have been very, very hard to build the Morris Canal without Lake Hopatcong's water, since we were the largest single source of water for the Morris Canal. And indeed, Lake Hopatcong owes its rise as a great resort to the fact that the Morris Canal attracted the train, of all things, to Lake Hopatcong to Nolan Point, which really started the great tourism boom at Lake Hopatcong. Okay, and Joe, thank you for your book also and your lovely maps. And this is a really good place to start, because we're really addressing a very, very narrow subject tonight. We're kind of talking about the Morris Canal from Shippingport to Brooklyn. We don't, you know, and we'll cover Nolan's Point because it was such an integral part of keeping the Morris Canal going for many years. So, I mean, basically, we go from here to here tonight. But in leading into Shippingport, we kind of like to start in Ledgewood to kind of get your feet on the ground. So if you were coming west on the Morris Canal, you would have come up the two planes at Ledgewood. You would have come past this bridge, which those of you that know, this would be really Route 46 today, or pretty darn close to where Route 46 is today. For those of you that like food, it's kind of across from Cliff's Ice Cream Parlor. But it just was one of those places where the Morris Canal went above the road. I guess it got a little wet under there once in a while. And it came out toward the lake that was originally known as Great Pond. And I have to tell you, Joe McKasey came up with the most amazing map this week that we had never seen a map of Great Pond that was really a drawn map of it before the Morris Canal was built. And Joe had it. He found it somewhere.
It was in our collection. And we asked Bob about it, and he gave us some thoughts about it, but don't know anything more about it than that. It just was there. We got some wonderful things.
And it's going to be added to our exhibit at the lake, and it's signed by George McCullough, or we think it was signed by George McCullough, and it shows the lake as he evidently saw it prior to the canal being built. We always kind of had some ideas about the size of the lake. This confirms some. Changes a few other thoughts, and it's amazing how many of the names of the lake, like River Styx and Byron Cove and Great Cove, were all on that map drawn around 1820. So kind of neat. Okay, here's Lake Hopatcong, or at least the southernmost part of Lake Hopatcong. This is all Roxbury, and kind of Hopatcong picks up over there. It's kind of neat to look at this map because it was taken in 1955 and you could still see the canal fairly clearly in 1955 in that it kind of came right through here at Shippingport, came right along the railroad track, and then kind of branched away, came out kind of diagonal, or I'm sorry, parallel to Lakeside Boulevard. Kind of it disappeared here because they didn't take the photo right for our purposes. And then all of a sudden it kind of picks up again and kind of comes into what is now Lake Hopatcong or Hopatcong State Park. So kind of neat. And this is kind of the area we're going to be talking about today. Today we know it as Shippingport Road. Well, once upon a time it was the location for the Morris Canal going through Shippingport. And Shippingport was this really named after Charles Shipman, early director of the canal. He had land on it. In fact, it appears he lost his job with the Morris Canal because of conflicts of interest with how he made money off of this part of the canal. But he had a thriving business here. It's reported he built boats here. He definitely had a sawmill going in this area. But this once looked more like this. And you had a plane east was located right here. You look at it today and you go, doesn't look like that much of a hill here. But that's how it looked when you came toward Lake Hopatcong. You would have had to go up the plane at Shippingport. And here, I guess we could go the where. What they found a way to do at Shippingport was they used the water coming down from the canal to run industries. At one point, it was known because they had two different businesses operating just off of that wastewater, if you will, of the Morris Canal. This picture was taken a bit later. You can see they were nice enough to put 1901 on the rock because they were camping here evidently that season. But it's an interesting perspective of what things look like at that period. The reason we're showing you this picture of plane number two is because it's a really nice picture of how kind of things operated with the way the water actually came out of a plane. Specifically, this area over here, the raceway. I mean, I think you folks call it some things other than raceways at time, but it's actually the water that after it came down through the plane and would come out. Because when you look at Shippingport, it's really interesting at Shippingport Road what you find. From that old Plane 1 East, under Shippingport Road, as many of you know who have hiked that or gone kind of under the road, that is actually Shippingport Road, and what's exactly underneath Shippingport Road is that. So it is kind of really neat that just has survived all those years and has been left alone. And you can walk pretty far in there. I've always been a little timid about walking in there, especially with all the bears and all at certain times of the year. It seems like good bear habitat. But that's right under Shippingport Road still to this day. And what do you have, running down from where you see this? In other words, picture yourself where you're sitting today. There you can see just how the water formerly ran, some almost 100 years after the canal was abandoned. And at Shippingport years ago, it was really two separate ponds you had there. Today, one of those ponds survives, the one on the right. But as you can see, they just built the towpath kind of right through, and the canal used to go right through.
That's a great picture.
What I love about this picture is there's the Lake Hopatcong train station. You can kind of see looking straight up the canal. So it kind of puts you in perspective of exactly where you were at the time. And here you see the view. And here's that pretty similar view today. You have the pond still on the right. You can still clearly see the towpath. And it's all nicely, and what's really nice about this property is I know that Canal Society has been very involved with Roxbury in preserving all this land, which is really neat. I think the agreements are in place now for that land behind the fire department.
We have the money. and we are in negotiations. We have a signed contract, and it's moving along. It's a real estate deal, and real estate deals always take longer or more complicated than you ever could imagine.
Well, as folks that were involved with buying that Lake Hopatcong train station, amen to everything you said. But yes, and it's just so neat that, you know, this many years later, at an area as developed as Lake Hopatcong has been, that you still find this here at Lake Hopatcong. And here you see, you know, the prism of the canal right over at that side off the road in Shippingport. Okay, we get the landing. This was a really, really unique part of the Morris Canal, as many of you know, in that the way they built the Lackawanna Railroad, at landing, they just came side by side. It didn't really last very long. The canal came up from Shippingport and then branched toward Lake Hopatcong. At the same time, the railroad was branching off toward Port Morris. But for a distance, they were side by side. And the folks that were running resorts at Lake Hopatcong, they kind of latched onto that pretty quickly, because you had this perfect situation where once the tourism industry started developing at Lake Hopatcong, and basically what happened was that railroad line was built in the 1750s, and no one really paid that much attention to it because it was not exactly on Lake Hopatcong. But in the 1880s, 1882 to be specific, the Central Railroad of New Jersey connected up their spur to Lake Hopatcong, and they started bringing tourists out to Lake Hopatcong. And it was very successful. So the Lackawanna said, well, our railroad line's pretty close to Lake Hopatcong too, and they started doing the tourism thing also. But what they had here was they could bring their train right up. Entrepreneurs put a steamboat company into effect, the Lake Hopatcong Steamboat Company, which was known as the Black Line. They would bring their boats right up the feeder canal to the main body of the Morris Canal, park them right here at the train station. You'd come up by train, walk right across the platform, a porter would help you with your luggage, load it onto the steamboat, and off you'd go up the canal, down the feeder canal, which we're gonna see that right in a little bit. Anywhere you want to go on Lake Hopatcong, to your hotel, to your cottage, to your campsite, wherever you're going. And it, you know, and it was a really nice way of doing it. And as you can see, there was a train station. The early train station was built right here. So the train, you know, came right up here and off you went onto the Morris Canal. Okay, the trolley came to Lake Hopatcong in 1908. You couldn't bring a trolley over the bridge that was there. So they had to build a new bridge over the Morris Canal. Built in 1908, it's the bridge that's still there today. And it's the bridge that they now, in 2015, are finally getting close to replacing. Something that a number of us in the room have been involved in as to what that bridge will exactly be. I don't think any of us deny that the bridge needs some work or possible replacement. We just would hate to see it go because that bridge is so connected with the Morris Canal, and how many bridges are left that had any direct involvement with the Morris Canal. So here it is when the bridge was being built, and shortly after it was built, when they still had a kind of a partial work bridge, you can see the kids took full advantage of it. we probably wouldn't swim in the Morris Canal today, but they had no problems with it then. In fact, at the Lake Hopatcong train station, there's an old fountain out back that we took us a while. We thought it was a horse trough, but we didn't know why they would bring horses back there. We finally got the drawings for the train station and realized it was a fountain. Well, it was two little chains you pulled, and water came down on either side, and there were metal cups connected with a chain. And you filled up your cup, you drank the water, and you put it down for the next person to drink. Health was looked upon differently back then. I think if something was going to kill you, it wasn't the cup, and it wasn't swimming in the Morris Canal necessarily. But it's always a really cute picture to see something like this. All right, there's that new bridge they built. That's the bridge that's still there today. And as you can see, that's how the Morris County Traction Line got out to Lake Hopatcong. And where would it eventually go? To Bertrand Island Park. Because like most trolley lines around the country, they were always looking for some reason people would want to take the trolley on weekends. So this was the end of the line. They built to a beach on Lake Hopatcong, figuring, people go swimming at the beach. Well, soon people wanted something else to do, so they built a shooting gallery, they built a dance hall, they put up a carousel. Next thing you know, a guy bought it and set up a full amusement park, and it truly became a trolley park, with the last stop on the trolley line being Virgin Island Park. Okay, there's, you know, the bridge as it looked. Doesn't look all that different today, just a little more worn. There it is today. And here we are where the parking is today for the train station. Unfortunately, as you'll see, that's where the Morris Canal used to go. Okay, 1911 comes along, the Lackawanna Railroad builds the big Lackawanna Cutoff. The Lackawanna Cutoff's gift to the Lake Hopatcong community is that train station. Probably, I won't say the only one, because I don't know that for a fact, but I think you'd be hard-pressed to find another train station that was built with a canal in mind, to kind of serve a canal also. You know, very unusual, because it was just normally, you know, trains just replaced canals. They didn't really supplement them. But here it was a little different. So everything was built in mind so that people arriving by train could go cross over the track and take the steamboats up to Lake Hopatcong. This still survives today. All this was taken down in 1982. It had been allowed to fall into tremendous disrepair. It was basically, these were elevators, one for your luggage, one for people that could come up. That's how the area looks today. Okay, here you have it. In fact, you even see the original freight line that used to go out to the ice houses on Lake Hopatcong, and more importantly, to the American Foresight Powder Company, a big industrial use that would later become Atlas Powder. A big residential community built there today. Probably could never happen under today's standards. But there are still people that constantly come into the museum and go, any idea why I have all this concrete in my yard? Because they still have the concrete reinforced bunkers from when they stored the explosives and the acids there. It was a big manufacturer during World War I. Okay, that view is basically that view today. And as you can see, this is right here is where the canal kind of headed toward Lake Hopatcong and the railroad headed to Fort Morris. Just a really, one of my favorite pictures of a canal boat, and it happened to be taken at landing. So we had to throw it in just because it's so good. Okay, if you would have taken a boat toward Lake Hopatcong, you would have gone, you know, west on the canal, and you would have come to an intersection. This is the intersection of where you either went straight and you went up towards Stanhope and eventually Waterloo, or you made the right turn here and you went to Lake Hopatcong. It was the feeder canal. Kind of calling it the feeder canal kind of has always annoyed us at the lake a little bit because it was fully navigable. In fact, a bunch of the early boats at Lake Hopatcong were brought up the Morris Canal and taken out this way. But it did feed water to the Morris Canal and connected Lake Hopatcong to the canal. In fact, you know, we always like, when people especially that don't know the canal, we try to explain where the canal went through and where this kind of feeder canal was. It happens to be where the Pathmark supermarket sits today, or pretty darn close to that exact location. So we tell them if they figure right around the appetizing department, they're probably fairly accurate. And that kind of is where that connection was made. Basically, from the Pathmark, or you know where that feeder canal was, you then would have had to cross what is today known as Center Street, and you would have had to go under this bridge. Of course, it looks a lot different today. It kind of looks like this today. The canal is, if you will, right in here. In fact, you can still see the little opening, and those of you that have walked on a feeder canal, and I think, Joe, you just had a group there.
Just last Sunday.
Yep, and you can walk just almost to this point, you know, and it's still a really pretty part of the canal. And then you would have, on the canal, you would have gone this way along the feeder. It was a really pretty stretch of the canal in there. Ah, see, Bob? Hypo had to make it into a couple of these slides.
Oh, yeah.
That was the photographer's dog. And it is amazing. You see him sitting on top of boats, not moving. I guess the photographer just put him down and said, stay, boy, and he stayed. Good old Hypo. Okay, this is what that feeder canal looked like just before you got to Lake Hopatcong. So picture yourself, you got off the train, you got onto that steamboat, and this would have been the view you would have had as you would have drawn closer to Lake Hopatcong. Here again, he was supposed to be the telegraph operator. And remember, in those years, if you had to get from one side of the canal to the other, if you weren't fortunate enough to be by a bridge, you created your own way to cross. And it seemed like he kept his own little kind of boat there to get across each day. Today, as you walk along, this is actually part of Hopatcong State Park. They don't advertise that because they say they don't have the ability to patrol it and all, so you kind of just have to go there like Joe when he took his group there last week. But it's a really nice park. The prism is very well preserved. I mean, what they did over the years was so that water wouldn't gather in it, they broke down the walls of it in places, and it's been pushed around a little bit as they expanded Lakeside Boulevard, which isn't far away over the years. But it's still a pretty nice stretch. You know, you still kick around in there, you'll find an old bottle, lots of coal that, you know, fell off of boats. And there's the towpath on a nice fall day that we pictured it at. And it's a great park. And there you see the prism. We have great hopes of tying this in with the whole Morris Canal Greenway that Joe is talking about, because it's just such a nice piece, and it will tie in beautifully to a trail we're developing around Lake Hopatcong that's going to be a complete trail around the lake. So hopefully this will get a lot more use in future years. It's occasionally used by cross-country teams today, or the Morris Canal fan, but other than that, it's barely seen. And, you know, for the state park people, they feel like, we can't patrol there, we don't want kids drinking there, blah, blah, blah. But, you know, it's such a shame to waste the resource like that. Okay, from there, you kind of came through. I mean, this would have been your boat as you were getting close to the state park. In fact, this is the equivalent of Lakeside Boulevard today. It was like located closer to the lake than the actual Lakeside Boulevard today. But this was the bridge that you would have gone under, and people who were crossing would have gone over. Good old hypo. And here you can start seeing the lock at the lake, you know, known as Brooklyn Lock, Hopatcong Lock. And Brooklyn because before there was a canal in the 1750s in this exact area where Hypo is sitting, there was a forge built. It was called the Brookland Forge. It actually served the American troops during the Revolution. The forge supplied things, a lot of iron parts. And that was indeed the first time the lake was ever dammed and raised a bit. So that was in this area here. And this area was known as Brookland. Well, over the years, it was corrupted to Brooklyn. You know, just from map to map, all of a sudden it starts showing up as Brooklyn, which people, I think, thought they were hearing anyway because of the more famous one in New York City. And that indeed, when the borough of Hopatcong was first incorporated, it was known as the borough of Brooklyn. Now, you can imagine when people were coming up for vacations and they were saying they were going to Brooklyn, it caused a lot of confusion. And just a few years later, they changed it to the borough of Hopatcong. Okay, we love this map because while it's not in great shape, it shows a lot of what was going on when you get into what we know today as Hopatcong State Park at the time. Here's your little bridge, and here would have been the canal coming up. Here's the lock tender's house. Here's your lock. Through the damming of the lake, first for the forge, then for the Morris Canal, the lake has been raised about 12 feet. Only good a guess as any. It was raised basically three different times. It was raised 1750s with an earth dam for the first forge that was there. The Morris Canal in the 1820s. And then in the 30s/40s period, they definitely raised it again because they needed more water. Right around that same time that they created Lake Musconetcong because they needed more water. So today the lake is about 12 feet higher from everything we know. You notice the outer pond and an outer lock. Boats could wade in here to go in. For a long time, this was known as a clam bake point because it was a really nice part to do a little clam bake on the lake. Now, going back to here, if you think of this area right here, just kind of to the left of the lock, that's where the dam was built today. In fact, where the dam was built in 1925 when the canal was abandoned. Basically, the lock is just off of this photo. And if you poke around, and people at, like Joe, who know a lot more about the canal than I do, he will show you parts where you kind of know where the lock was. What was really interesting, which I never recognized until we were doing an engineering survey of the fountain that was built as part of the canal abandonment, they did a bunch of aerial photos and things, and that actual first gate in the dam, they have a whole bunch of gates, you can just see them here. Well, the first one, when you see it from the air, you actually see it actually was just where the lock was, which is why the water flow there is a bit different than every other one. They just, you know, they didn't change things. They didn't need to change that. And it's really kind of an interesting aspect. Okay, so if you were coming up by boat, you would have kind of come right through here under the bridge, as this group did. Don't you always wonder when you see boats like this, it's like, did they have no safety standards at all back then? It's like, what keeps this lady from falling into the canal is absolutely beyond me, but they look like they're having a good time. So this is all Hopatcong State Park today. In fact, you're just basically past where the museum is. And your friendly lock tender would have been waiting for you for many, many years. It was the Messenger family who lived in what is our museum building today. In you went into the lock. Here you are coming. And that is probably, most certainly, Reuben Messenger up there. There you are. I love the way they keep the boat away from banging against the wall. And it's funny, when you read the accounts, some people hated coming up to the lake this way. In fact, that's why they would, when they gave them a different way to come, when they created Landing Channel, they would take the other steamboat company. Because evidently, when the water was let into the lock, and I guess a lot of you have done canal tours where you go up, kind of go, I guess the boat really shook a lot when they let the water in, and that wasn't a favorite of everybody's. But here they are with the water kind of at low part. And here they are just about to be released onto Lake Hopatcong. And for those of you who know the lake, that's where Bertrand Island is. In fact, that actually was the Breslin Hotel, built in 87. It just dominated Mount Arlington. It made it into this photo. And that's like Point Pleasant over there. Okay, and if you were part of the Messinger family, you used the canal for everything. In fact, we have the accounts where evidently they kept, they used to catch a lot of eels at the canal. I don't know why they used to have a box there, and it was evidently considered good eating because we have the accounts in our museum of the eels that they would catch there. And of course, we have some of the hardware that they would use. Not that appealing today, but popular back then. We don't know if that's Herb or not. He's actually the one that had visited us. He just recently passed away. He had lived for a really long time. He used to always walk into our museum and point out which room was his bedroom, and he was very helpful with where the outhouses used to be and things like that. There you can see, it looks like, in fact, that tool looks like it was probably made for eels. Now, this was the outer pond that you saw, that area where the boats could wait to enter the lock. You know, he came in here and there was a waiting line to get through. And you could also, I guess, do boat repairs here and other things. Here's what that same area looks like today. It's still, as the dam is built, they never really changed the basic, you know, area here. Of course, the homes have changed a little bit. And here is a nice close-up of that outer lock. You know, and basically, you know, you read the accounts and all, they would just close this lock when they needed to do maintenance on the inner lock. You know, they could cut off the flow of water here. And here's, you know, here you see, this is like a private boat. It's not even one of the steamboats. It used to be kind of popular to do a little excursion. Like, you know, you take your little private boat in and you might go down to like Suckasana or, you know, Ledgewood, you know, back then Drakesville, things like that. You didn't go very far. In fact, usually I didn't go anywhere near as far as like Dover, because it took a while to get through the plains and all. But you took a little excursion with your friends. Okay, now going back to this, you see these posts? Believe it or not, this many years later, those posts are still there. They appear every 5 years when they drop the lake. They do a major drop of 5 feet every 5 years. And what's left of these posts, here they are. It's kind of amazing that they never took them out because they didn't think they needed to. The water is over them most of the time. And two, that natural force is kind of just the coldness of the water and everything else protect them. Okay. The reason we kind of just showing this map is to kind of explain how the Morris Canal really had a huge effect on Lake Hopatcong. In this area up here, and really over here more, there's a lot of iron ore. In fact, people at Lake Hopatcong know it, like probably Anita, because they have to like probably soften their water to be able to drink it. But Jefferson is rich in iron ore, all the way up into Ogdensburg, or at the time it was Sparta back then. The problem was, it was really hard to get this iron ore out of the mines and to market. Putting them out on horses and wagons just wasn't very effective. So they were kind of looking for ways to do it. Once the Morris Canal opened, what they would do is they put it on horses and wagons and they take it part to the closest part of the lake that we know, actually at the time it was owned by a gentleman by the name of William Wood. And he kind of built a little dock area and all in this area, and it was called Wood's Port. We know it today as Woodport part of Lake Hopatcong. It still keeps that name. So they would take it down here, and then literally steamboats would tow it up the lake and out to the Morris Canal right over here.
Down the
lake. Yeah, they would take it straight south on the lake, down the lake. For years, once railroads started developing in the country, the mines started thinking about, like, hey, how can we get our iron ore to Lake Hopatcong more efficiently other than putting it on horse and wagon? So they came up with the idea of building a railroad to Lake Hopatcong. It wasn't really with any intent of getting around the canal, it was literally a railroad to connect it to the canal. So they were kicking this around for a while. Civil War breaks out, tremendous need for iron ore. They charted this railroad called the Ogden Mine Railroad, all of 10 miles long from Ogdensburg to Lake Hopatcong. Well, as long as you're going through the trouble of building a railroad, it was like, why build it to the northern part of the lake? There's a lot of stumps in here, it's shallow water, especially with the Morris Canal, the water would be down a lot in the summer. So they picked the deepest part of Lake Hopatcong, which we know today as Nolan's Point. It's about 65 feet off of here. And they say, we'll build a railroad from all these mines, you know, from the old Edison mine down through the Dodge, the Weldon, the Schofield mines, the Heard mine, about where Route 15 is today, and we'll bring it right along the lake and right up to this point over here. And from here, we'll load the iron ore onto canal boats, we'll pull them by steamboat up to the state park, well, it wasn't the state park then, but up to where the Morris Canal is, and then we'll take them out on the Morris Canal. Of course, it doesn't quite work out the way they planned because they don't get the railroad built in 1866, so they missed the Civil War. But indeed, from 1866 until 1882, it was the single largest source of cargo for the Morris Canal. And here it is. Here's this 10-mile-long railroad. And originally, it did connect with the Ogden mines, which was actually a zinc mine, and then hooked up with all these iron ore mines. But because of all this and all, we still find chunks of iron ore. In fact, up in the Woodport area, every once in a while, someone brings us a nice piece of zinc that fell off the canal boats. And here you got the railroad. This would be going toward Nolan's Point down from Ogdensburg and Jefferson. A very rare image of that Ogden's Mine Railroad when it was working purely as an iron mine. That would be those of you who know the lake today, that's Halsey Island. In fact, if you know the lake today, this would kind of be where the Windlass Restaurant is. The early ore dock, here you go. The trains would bring it down, and they'd put it on right into canal boats. Yep. And to, you know, the one really, really good photo we have of this, thank you, Bob Goller, is this photo. It is, when Bob first got us this photo, it was like amazing. It was like, because if those of you know the lake a bit, this is like sitting in the Jefferson House restaurant, because that's exactly where you're seated. And here it is. It's right there. You see the railroad track where Nolan's Point Park Road is today. And here you really have, like, for the first time, an idea of what was going on here at the lake. And indeed, you know, it's funny how when they used to take things apart, like, okay, we don't need this anymore, they just took off the top part. They didn't bother with the other stuff. And here again, when you have to drop, this you see every year because they take the lake down about 20 inches. At the 5 feet drawdown, you see it a lot. But there it is, the whole base of that old ore dock is still there, under this poor guy's dock. I'm sure he parks his boat very carefully. But there it is. It's pretty great, actually, when you see it that way today. Okay, we're taking it back off Lake Hopatcong, and we're taking it back to the area we know today as Hopatcong State Park. So you're coming back through the lock. Yep, see, you're coming through the lock, and this guy's gonna fall in too. You could tell it was photo day, though. Everybody was out. Okay, what do you find in Hopatcong State Park today? Well, you find a turbine from Plane 3. Somehow, when they were taking apart the canal, they had the foresight to say, we ought to save one of these somewhere. And it was being set up as a park, and for whatever reason, they took it over to the Hopatcong State Park. And as you know, they've done it. It's not really interpreted over there, and for you folks that know the canal a lot, you have a good idea of how this used to sit underground and all. Most people don't really get the full grasp of it other than it's very big. But at least they did save it. In fact, Jim Lee Sr., when he was alive, always used to say, if I could just get that thing down into my, I'd have all the parts I need. Okay, and that's where it came from, that turbine that you see. Okay. So you're coming back toward the state park, you see right there, that's the lock tender's house. Here you see the Musconetcong River, because this is where, Lake Hopatcong is the headwaters for the Musconetcong River. So here's where it all starts, and there you see the canal. This is kind of what the area looks like today. We took this about 6 weeks ago when we were messing around with the fountain. We're trying to get it start working again. This fountain was actually part of the Morris Canal abandonment. It was a compromise, a political compromise, believe it or not, in 1925 to how to measure the flow of Lake Hopatcong, because there was this idea of everybody who had those hotels, and at its peak we had 40 hotels and rooming houses operating at the lake, and in mid-20s was its peak. You're trying to operate a resort, you want to protect your water. You don't want mud at the end of your dock. The people on the Musconetcong River, who have all the mills and active businesses going, they want water flow. So that was a big fight about it then. This was how they decided to measure it. They sent a specific flow of water. Like, you remember what it was, Anita? It's like 12 million somethings, you know. And it was measured through a 12-inch pipe, and it flowed up into the fountain, and out it went into the Musconetcong River. This has been turned off since the 80s. We're looking to see if we can get it going. It would probably never measure the flow of the lake again for a lot of different reasons, but it would be nice to see it, and it really was a part of the abandonment. The engineers and all involved with the abandonment did this personally. And there you see, in 1925, when they started up the fountain. And, indeed, for people who used to come up to Lake Hopatcong, we still have people that come in the museum and say, when I was a kid, we used to always come up to the fountain. So there's a lot of nostalgia there, but it completely ties in with the abandonment of the canal. Okay. So you're leaving Lake Hopatcong, here you come, you see the canal house, the lock tender's house right here as you go by, really nice shot of it over here, and that's how the building looks today. Canal just used to come right here, and of course, here's our little tribute at Lake Hopatcong to Hudson Maxim, who was not often a favorite with people at the Morris Canal since he really led the abandonment efforts for the Morris Canal. Wealthy industrialist, owned a lot of land at Lake Hopatcong, lived on Lake Hopatcong, together with the hotel interests and all. Their biggest enemy was the Morris Canal because it took their water. In a dry summer like this year, the lake could be down 4.5-5 feet. And and we know this year they're squealing because the lake's down a foot. So you can imagine how it was. And there you see it has a lock tender's house with the Messenger family, 1898. The whole family was out for this photo. I guess Dad was in the doghouse. He didn't seem like he was anywhere near the rest of the family that day. And there's our building today. And, you know, it was pure, probably, luck that this building was saved. In the 1960s, they built this, when the canal was abandoned, this became the headquarters for the Hopatcong State Park. And served that way, with the messengers still running it, he became the first superintendent of the Hopatcong State Park. So he just went from one job to the other, and that was very good. Well, and this stayed that way until the park started getting bigger and bigger in the 50s. So by the early 60s, they said, we need a bigger place. So they built a big, kind of long, ugly building, you know, catty-corner to it, and they were about to tear down this building. And it was just fortunate that there was a group of folks at Lake Hopatcong, in the Lake Hopatcong Historical Society at the time, that had been looking for a home for about the last 7-8 years. And they were able to get this building from the state. And indeed, this month is our 50th anniversary of having the museum open.
I lived in Hopatcong years back, and it was a messenger family. Has anyone ever come in that lived in Hopatcong?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we're still in touch with them. In fact, he just passed away about a year ago.
So those are relatives?
Herb did. But, yeah, there's still actually family still in Mount Arlington.
Okay.
Yeah. We've kind of, over the years, especially when he was moving out of Pennsylvania, we got all kinds of stuff that he insisted came out of the house, so we assume it did. Some of the things, as we know, we were talking about the other day, look a little more recent, because they're aluminum, but other things certainly go well back with the canal. And we have a bunch of neat things from the family. Okay. That pretty much is about what I have to say about the Morris Canal at Lake Hopatcong, because as you can tell, we came back to where we started from. But I'd love to take any questions that you have or anything else that you would like to talk about Lake Hopatcong. I myself, it was like, it was up already?